Hey everyone, it's Professor Dave. I want to tell you some things about the Diels-Alder reaction.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So every Diels-Alder reaction is going to have two key players here. There's going to be a diene and a dienophile. So a diene, as you might expect, is an alkene with two pi bonds. So this is the diene. There's a pi bond there and a pi bond there. And the dienophile is the thing that reacts with the diene. And so what is common of every Diels-Alder reaction is that we're going to be forming a six-membered ring. This is very useful in synthetic chemistry because there are a lot of naturally occurring compounds that we wish to synthesize that have six-membered rings. This is a very stable ring and is utilized a lot in nature. So what happens is this is a concerted reaction where the pi electron density is shuffled around. So this is how we're going to draw these arrows. It is arbitrary which direction around the ring we draw the arrows because it is, this is a concerted reaction. It's not the case that these pi bonds are moving one at a time. But what ends up happening is that whereas we had three pi bonds to begin with shuffling around, what we're going to get is one pi bond remaining and two new sigma bonds. So that's these here. And so if we look at the transition state, we basically have a six-membered ring of partial pi electron density. And so that's illustrating how all of this is shuffling around at once. But what we end up with is always going to be a six-membered ring with one pi bond. And here are our two new sigma bonds. So there's an element of stereospecificity to examine here. Let's say we're looking at a cis dienophile. A cis dienophile will add in syn fashion to the diene, and that will result in these R groups being cis to one another on the product. Whereas if we have a trans dienophile, that is going to add in anti fashion to the diene, and so that is going to give us the groups trans to one another in the product. However, whereas this is certainly stereospecific because cis on this side or the other would yield the same product, here there is still an element of variability depending on which face of the alkene is approached. We could have a wedge and a dash here or a dash and a wedge, and those would in fact be two different molecules. So, so once again, cis alkenes add syn, and trans alkenes add anti. So the situation with butadiene and ethene was a very simplified situation. Let's take a look at a more complicated one where both the diene and the dienophile are already rings themselves. So the way to draw the correct product is to always recall that we are forming a six-membered ring between the four carbons that are doubly bound carbons in the diene and the two carbons in the dienophile. So let's number these just to be sure what's going on. Or here, let's do 5, 6. Okay. So always be aware that we are forming a six-membered ring between these six carbons, and then everything else is just sort of where it already is. So this is what we're going to get. Now, the reason this looks a little funny is that we have a five-membered ring. We have these carbons participating in both this five-membered ring and the new six-membered ring. So if we go ahead and draw these arrows, we can see where that new six-membered ring is going to be, right? So let's draw them in. But the point is that this carbon right here that was in the five-membered ring, that is not participating in the new six-membered ring, but it didn't go anywhere. It's still there. And so basically we have this situation where we have an additional carbon jutting up out of the board a little bit, and so that's going to still be there, and then the rest of the maleic anhydride will be projecting downwards. So every Diels-Alder product will have a six-membered ring, and it will be formed from specifically those six carbons that we just discussed. So that's the easy part. The hard part is trying to figure out where all the other stuff is. So we want to always make sure that we're not adding or subtracting any carbon or any material, and we want to make sure that all of the bonds are where they're supposed to be. So it is the case that we're always just going to be moving these three pi bonds. One of them will remain a pi bond, but then the other two will go to form these new sigma bonds. So those are the new bonds there, and so therefore that's the new six-membered ring. Let's take a look at it from a different viewpoint. So imagine that we are looking at these molecules edge on, and so this is the case with the Diels-Alder reaction. In order for the orbitals to line up, remember that these are p orbitals extending perpendicular from the plane of the molecule. So one, the diene must be lowered onto the dienophile, and then so that's how the chemistry occurs. So once again, this is the same product from a side view. Here's that bridgehead carbon. That's the fifth carbon on the diene that was not participating in the reaction, and then here are these two new bonds that are forming the new six-membered ring. So let's go ahead and number this one. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So those are the carbons that correspond to these, which are the ones that correspond to these. In any given reaction, it is always the case that one molecule is dumping electron density from its highest occupied molecular orbital into the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital of some other molecule. With the Diels-Alder, that's very important to look at because it may or may not be the case that a Diels-Alder reaction is possible depending on the configuration of the molecular orbitals. So let's take a look at butadiene here. So if you look at the orbital diagram, there are four pi electrons that need to be accounted for. So two fit in each orbital. So here are the first two in the first orbital, and then the second orbital contains one node. So that is what is going to put us in this configuration here with the node, with the lobes oriented as they are. So that's the highest occupied molecular orbital on butadiene, and then the dienophile, electron density is being dumped into those, so we need to examine the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital that the electron density is going to go into. So over here, we have one orbital full with the two pi electrons, and then the lowest unoccupied one is this one with one node. And so we can see here that everything is in phase and ready to undergo the Diels-Alder reaction. These are going to overlap nicely, and these are going to overlap nicely. However, if there were more pi electrons, or this molecule was different in some way, such that these were not in phase, then the Diels-Alder reaction would not be able to occur. So that's something to keep in mind. We always have to check the orbital diagram to make sure that a Diels-Alder reaction is possible. Now, there's one other point that we want to discuss. The diene can approach the dienophile in either exo or endo fashion. And so that's not necessarily implying exothermic or endothermic. They're terms that are describing the geometry of what's going on here. So it is an exo Diels-Alder reaction if any groups projecting from the dienophile are extended away from the diene. So this is going to lower down, and this is probably more sterically favorable. There's not as much steric hindrance associated with an exo Diels-Alder reaction. Whereas with the endo, see how the R groups now are projecting directly under the plane of the diene as it approaches. So this can have something to do with the transition state of the Diels-Alder reaction if there are functional groups present such that some kind of an interaction can occur, or a slight stabilizing effect between maybe some electron deficient groups where the pi electrons can interact with those groups in the transition state of the molecule. So depending on what's going on, exo or endo may be favored for varying kinetic or thermodynamic reasons. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.